Remember the fact that that's La. Because you're doing it then.
Is to be for all who will. We pray to Lord,
we bless you,
we adore you,
we glorify you,
we give you thanks for your
of all of us assembled here, we would like to welcome all who are visiting with us, and to all who are new to our parish family, welcome. If you've not already done so, we ask that all cell phones and any other electronic devices please be silenced at this time. Deacon Jim will be assisting Father Jim, who will lead us in the celebration of the Eucharist. Please stand. We invite everyone to please pick up your songbooks and join in singing our gathering song, number 574, number 574.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each of you this morning.
And with your spirit.
I will have to say this, because I was not here for their debut, but it is so good to hear our choir. You are brave and great ministers of God's word when you sing. Mm-hmm. And so we are so appreciative of that. Friends, discipleship calls us to make radical choices about how we live as followers of Jesus. As we celebrate Mass today, let us reflect on how we have experienced God's grace in our lives and ask God's pardon for the times we have failed, for the strength to be faithful disciples.
Lord Jesus, you desire to show us the way of salvation. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you call disciples to act in your name. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, in you we find peace and fullness and compassion. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us your sins. Bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Beyond all human boundaries, O God, your deeds and power take place, and your healing mercy is at work. Ours is not to restrict the wonders of your saving grace, but to give joyful thanks for your compassion wherever we may find it. Teach us to use wisely the wishes of your nature and grace, to care generously for those in need, and to look carefully into our own conduct. Grant this to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Reading from the book of Numbers. The Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to Moses. Taking some of the spirit that was on Moses, the Lord bestowed it on 70 elders. And as the spirit came to rest on them, they prophesied. Now two men, one named Eldad, the other Medad, were not in the gathering, but had been left in the camp. They too had been on the list, but had not gone to the tent. Yet the Spirit came to rest on them also, and they prophesied in the camp. So when a young man quickly told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp," Joshua, the son of Nun, who from his youth had been Moses' aide, said, "Moses, my lord, stop them." But Moses answered him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the people of the Lord were prophets. Would that the Lord might bestow his spirit on them all." The word of the Lord. Reading from the letter of St. James. Come now, you rich, weep and wail over your impending miseries. Your wealth has rotted away, your clothes have become moth-eaten, your gold and silver have corroded. And that corrosion will be a testimony against you. It will devour your flesh like fire. Yet you have stored up treasure for the last days. Behold, the wages you withheld from the workers who harvested your fields are crying aloud, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on earth in luxury and pleasure. You have fattened your hearts for the day of slaughter. You have condemned. You have murdered the righteous one. He offers you no resistance. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
At that time, John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we tried to prevent him because he does not follow us." Jesus replied, "Do not prevent him. There is no one who performs a mighty deed in my name who can at the same time speak ill of me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Anyone who gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, will surely not lose his reward. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed than with two hands to go into Gehenna, into the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life crippled than with two feet to be thrown into Gehenna. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. Better for you to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into Gehenna, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I learned two things during formation about the second reading. We had a teacher who described it like the appetizer and said, sometimes it complements. You may have some kind of meat with beef. And other times it contradicts a little bit, like when you have some kind of seafood before you have a steak. The other thing I found out is not everybody holds the letter of James in the high regard that I did. I've always thought it inspiring, I thought it powerful, and I'm always surprised at such a small letter, only 5 chapters and less than 2,500 words. So my first year, we were assigned to write a paper on the letters. So I asked to write James, and I was stunned. The professor tried to talk me out of it. She told me the letter was inconsequential, and she didn't like it because it contradicted Paul. And then, kind of nasty, she said to me, "Who wrote it?" So I said, "There's 3 figures named James." I said, "But it's most likely the one called the brother of the Lord." And she said, "But it doesn't say that. Maybe it was James the Fuller brush salesman." So just as sarcastically, I said, "He's not in the Bible." So after that conversation, she let me do that research. And I have to tell you, I came away more convinced of the importance of the second readings that we have from James, which we won't see again for another cycle. It kind of complements the Old and the New Testament. Last week, or in the beginning of the James cycle, he told us, be doers of the word, to our detriment if we don't. And you ask yourself, boy, that sounds familiar. And then you think in Matthew and Luke, Jesus used the parable of those who listen will build a house on stone. So when the storm comes, their house will stand. And those who don't listen will lose it all. And then he said that James tells us that God chooses those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom. And we all sit back and go, oh yeah, the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor, for they shall have the kingdom of God. My favorite, when James asks, how can we possibly walk into a church and pass a naked or a hungry woman or man and stop and smile and say, hey, eat well, stay warm, and not do anything to change their condition? And then we remember in Matthew again, Jesus taught, I was a stranger, you invited me in. I was naked, you clothed me. I was hungry, you fed me. I was sick, you cared for me. I was in prison, you visited. And then he reminds us, what you do for the least of my brothers and sisters, you do for me. And I guess the other one, Jesus in the Beatitudes says, blessed are the peacemakers, they'll be the children of God. And James reminds us, the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace for those who love peace. Jesus told us, ask and you will receive. Knock, the door will be open. All those who seek will find. James tells us we don't have because we don't ask properly. And just an interesting thing. Do you know anointing of the sick comes from this very epistle, this little five-chapter book? James says, when a member in the community is ill, call the elders to pray over them and to anoint them with oil. 2,000 years ago, two of the most popular medicines were wine and oil. They were used to treat cuts and bruises. So he's telling you to have faith, call the elders to pray, but also to have deeds, to anoint them with oil. And I have to tell you, in our time, I see t-shirts that say faith over fear, and I'm confused. And I was talking to a gentleman who was wearing one, and I asked him, what does that symbolize? And he said, I'm not afraid of the pandemic. And I said, okay. I said, what do you do to protect others that might be vulnerable? Well, he said, nothing. And I said, well, then what kind of faith do you have? I said, you have to have some faith. I said, you don't want the vaccine? Okay, but wear a mask and distance. I said, that little show of faith helps others who are in fear because they're at risk. And he didn't understand that. He thought the t-shirt was enough. And I said, James tells us, faith without deeds is dead. So it's amazing. This little letter packs such a powerful punch. And yes, he's dismissed in the Gospels as a non-believer. And he's called the brother of the Lord. Now, we're uncertain. The word that was used in his time could mean cousin, could mean stepbrother, could mean blood brother. They were a tribal people. And in their mentality, if your father and my father are brothers, that kind of makes us brothers. So it's kind of a stretching on the word. Either way, he didn't believe in Jesus in his lifetime. That's documented in the Gospels. But after he encountered the resurrected Christ, he was transformed. And for the next 30 years, stayed in Jerusalem, feeding and nourishing the church, and died as a martyr. Because when they told him, stand in the synagogue and say, Jesus isn't the Son of God, he refused. And they threw him from the rooftop and they stoned him. And we know this, that he was changed by an encounter with the resurrected Christ because of Paul. In a letter to the Corinthians, Paul tells us, after the resurrection, he appeared to Peter. He was a believer. And then the 12 believers. And then the 500. They were believers. And then he appeared to James, and last of all, Paul. Two men who in their lifetime denied Christ was who he claimed to be. And after encountering the resurrected Christ, followed him to their death. And now what of us? Have we not been changed by our encounter with the resurrected Christ when we come here to receive the Eucharist? We have to ask ourselves, am I like James sometimes? Do I see and deny? Do I not hear because I choose not to? And I can tell you something. 10 years ago, I was in this church at a daily mass, and they read from Corinthians. And I was really, really touched by that, James being changed by that encounter. So after mass, I went and kneeled before the tabernacle because I was wrestling with so many issues. Am I going to retire? I have sons in college. I'm being called to the diaconate, but am I worthy? I don't know. So I knelt before the tabernacle and I had a conversation, just Jesus and me, face to face. Now, I wouldn't tell you to do what I did because I said, Lord, by any means necessary. And 6 months later, I fell on brack ice. I broke my ankle in 3 places and the decision was made. I couldn't work anymore and I went into the diaconate. Now, Father John last week said God sends helicopters and rowboats. I would have been happy if he sent an email. But all kidding aside, Jesus is here, body and blood, soul and divinity. And the red light is on to remind you when you come here, he's there and he's waiting. The question each of us needs to answer is, will I answer the invitation?
Friends, we profess our faith. I believe in God,
Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, the Son of the Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died in the grave,
he descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. There he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
life everlasting.
Friends, having been nourished by the word of God, let us confidently place our intentions before the Lord, knowing that he hears the cries of all who are in need.
May all members of the church be faithful disciples who act in Jesus' name in serving others. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May our nation always strive to live up to our ideals, taking special care of those without political or economic power and working for the common good. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May those in our church and parish community who generously give of themselves in service to others, who we thank this Sunday at our parish volunteer appreciation dinner dance, will continue to receive God's grace and blessings. We pray to the Lord. May all members of this parish community work together in harmony to create spaces where all are welcomed and valued. We pray to the Lord. May Raymond Dobbin and all who followed Christ in this life and served others come to reward of life forever as Christ promises. We pray to the Lord. May God grant these needs which we hold in our hearts. For these needs, and for Raymond McManus, Esther and Phil Perchy, Patrick Coyne, Eugene P. Warshall, Fred DeLeon, George Ranviak, Manuel Castell Loxon, Mary Munoz, Beatrice Gibson, George E. Halo, and all the people of the parish, we pray to the Lord.
God of all blessings, send down your Spirit on us always to strengthen our faith and increase our humility. Give us the wisdom to see your hand in the goodness that comes into our lives, into our world, and into our future. Grant all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Without my vision, O Lord, I Friends, please pray that our sacrifice this morning be acceptable to God who is Almighty. Grant, merciful God, that this our offering may find acceptance with you, and that through it, in the wellspring of all blessing, that it may be laid open before us. And grant this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through this Paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death. He has summoned us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession. To proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so now with your angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with the hosts and the powers of heaven, we sing with them the great hymn of your glory. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fountain source of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread. Giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his beloved friend, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his beloved disciple, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Great is the mystery of our faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by your Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout our world. Bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, David, our Bishop, with the clergy, religious, and all those whom you call to belong to the body of Christ. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her husband, with your blessed apostles and martyrs, with Saint Rose and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Friends, as disciples who follow Jesus on the way to the kingdom, let us pray now with childlike trust. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days. By the help of your mercy, may we always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, for you live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer one another the sign of Christ's peace.
Gifts of God for the holy people of God. Draw near with awe and faith, with praise and thanksgiving. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be
in
act of spiritual communion for our brothers and sisters who are celebrating with us from home. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things. And I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you and unite myself wholly to you. Friends, let us pray. May this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be co-heirs in glory with Christ, to whose suffering we are united whenever we proclaim his death, for he lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
We have the following announcements for the week. All who are making online donations through John Patrick Giving, our old bulletin company, need to switch their accounts to our new company, We Share Online. Log on to the parish website to make donations online. The annual blessing of animals in honor of St. Francis of Assisi will be held next Sunday, October 3rd, 1:30 p.m. in front of the Youth and Parish Conference Center, the old convent. And now I have an infomercial for you. We have been slowly and steadily rebuilding our team of liturgical ministers as we respond to the current stage of the pandemic. The invitation to serve as a liturgical minister has been running in the bulletin for some time, but more help is needed. We need you. And we could certainly use a couple of ministers, Eucharistic ministers, at this Mass as well. We normally would have four downstairs, and if the choir's here, one upstairs, so we're a little short. Get the message? Mm-hmm. It's every baptized person's responsibility to share in Christ's mission and of his church in various manners according to the gifts that are given. All are given a gift, some sort, or gifts of some sort. It's a duty and a privilege to assist at Mass. You are right if you say, I am not worthy. None of us are worthy, so we get that out of the way right off the bat. But God equips us to do what he asks us to do and gives us the grace, the forgiveness, and the support we need. In every generation, in every season, new members are needed and called to continue God's work. We ask that you prayerfully consider if God is calling you to serve in one of the following ways. Perhaps as a member of the Liturgy Planning Commission or Art and Environment Subcommittee, as a sacristan, a lector, an extraordinary minister of the Eucharist, a music minister, an altar server, usher, or hospitality minister, as an extraordinary minister who brings communion either to the hospital or to the nursing home or to those who are homebound. As a church or chapel sacristan who cares for the building, vestments, and linens. So there's a particular need for ministers at the following masses. Lectors at the 7 a.m. and 11 a.m. Mass. Extraordinary ministers at the Eucharist, especially at the 12:30, but also at this Mass. Sacristans are needed at all masses, and ushers especially needed at the 11 and the 12:30. And you can see today's bulletin if you would like further information. Okay. The Lord be with you.
Bow your heads for the blessing.
Friends, may the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Seeking to follow the teacher who came not to be served, but to serve, go in peace to love and and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Have a beautiful day today.